Hello, Manfred. Great to see you here today. Your topic is leadership in the age of pandemics. And can you hear me?
I can hear you. I had started already, but I think I have a second start. Why not? Let's start.
Yeah, again. This is a live thing, so all those kinds of surprises happen. That's
I heard you talking about the Wolf of Wall Street. Mm-hmm. Not a role model for the Russian leadership, but another story. Do they want to be locked up in prison for a while? As a leadership professor, I get quite excited about hearing about the Wolf of Wall Street. Anyhow, continue.
Yeah. Leadership is what Dutch people know a lot about, because since the medieval times, you are leaders in the art. You know, your artists are really famous worldwide, and now in the 21st century, you are leaders in the youth culture, in the EDM culture. Once again, your artists are the best in the world. Small country, but really talented people. So maximum respect from Russia, from Moscow to Netherlands. I've been there in the Netherlands several times, and I want to come again. Nothing compares to Amsterdam, to the channels, to this atmosphere. You are really cool. Maximum respect.
But you know, I live in France since 50
years. Oh, really?
I mean, I like Amsterdam. I lived there for 7 years, but I basically live more than 50 years in France. At the moment, I'm somewhere on top of a mountain in the south of France.
South of
France. Nice place to be.
All right. I love France as well. That's the power of Europe. Everything is so close. Everything is so connected. Old Mother Europe. We love her.
It is Mother Russia, by the way, not Mother Europe. That's the real mother, Mother Russia. I've never heard of Mother Europe. You have, of course, in France, you have Marianne. That's the woman, that's true, from the revolution. Mm-hmm. But sorry, I'm interrupting you. I mean, I'm supposed to talk about leadership in a pandemic age. My apologies.
No, everything is fine. So are we ready to start? Okay, so now we give the stage to the speaker in the very interesting topic of leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Manfred Katz de Vries.
Thank you very much. Can you see my slides, by the way? No answer. All right. Privyet, all of you. I'm very pleased to be able to talk to you again. This is the second time. The first time was live in the Moscow Olympic Stadium, which was quite an experience with so many people. Normally, I try to have lots of interaction with my audience, but now I am two-dimensional, so it is a very, very different story. I want to say a few things. I don't have that much time about leadership and also the psychological impact of the pandemic. As the kind introduction said, I actually have two hats. On one hand, I'm a psychoanalyst, and the other side, I'm also a management professor. I teach at a place outside Paris, which also has establishments in Singapore, Abu Dhabi, and in San Francisco. Also, I'm the chairman of a consulting firm called the Katz de Vries Institute. Now, to start off, I want to do a little test, which is difficult when I don't see you. But the test is, look at those two pictures. When you look at those pictures of this young man and young woman, I mean, they look rather nice, shy, pleasant, maybe a little bit timid in certain ways. But the question I always ask as a psychoanalyst, is what you see really what you get? And when you look at the whole painting, the paintings by two very famous people, one is Titian and one is Caravaggio. You see, those are not nice scenes. It's Salome receiving the head of John the Baptist, and it's David holding the head of Goliath. So, and that is what I always try to do. For example, to give you another illustration, there is something called Plato's Allegory of the Cave. You might not have heard of it, but it's imagine that you are a prisoner. You're tied up, and behind you is a fire, and sometimes people walk behind you, and so you see their images projected on the wall, shadows. It's like looking at me, two-dimensional. It's a gray, I'm not gray in this case, I'm in color, but gray, black, two-dimensional. Now imagine that you escape. You get rid of no longer being tied up. You get out, and suddenly you are in a three-dimensional world of colors. Now, what can you tell people who come back when you come back to the cave, going from a three-dimensional to two-dimensional? It's very hard. So the world I deal with has to do with dreams, fantasies, daydreams, and slips of the tongues. They're all related, and symbolism, of course, is a very powerful thing in the Russian culture. So I ask people usually the question, do you want to go through life unconsciously, or do you want to be more aware of what is happening around you? Do you want to be a stranger to yourself? Most people, which I've discovered in my work, don't know themselves very well. I mean, I run once a year at INSEAD and what I sometimes describe as a CEO recycling seminar, but it's a leadership program. It's very popular among Russians. I've had many, many Russians in the program. And basically, there I try to help them to become more three-dimensional. Let me give you another slide. You know, I help people to become more reflective leaders. Most of them aren't. They are too quick. They shoot and then and aim. They're too quick. It's important that people realize when something happens to have some reflection on it. I have actually an old friend who makes the joke. He said, I always fall in love with narcissistic women. But he said, I've learned I don't marry them any longer. So he has learned to be more reflective. The other thing is I try to help people build more effective teams. I try to help them to make organizations better places to work. And many organizations in Russia, associated with quite a few organizations in Russia, too many of them are still fairly Darwinian. It's a Darwinian soup, I call it. It's rank or jank. It's not a very pleasant environment. And also, of course, which is most importantly, I like to have executives to have a more balanced lifestyle, which is also not very often the case. By the way, this is famous Gallup poll. And of the Gallup, 85% of employees worldwide are not engaged. Think about that. If you can improve that, how much more effective they would be working. It's a terrible figure. 85%, that includes Russia too. Maybe I don't exact the figure for Russia, but this is worldwide. This is not just Western countries. To continue, in my work, I use a more psychodynamic systemic orientation. Sounds very difficult word, but a clinical orientation. I try to be close to the people. To really understand what's going on. In that respect, I try to go beyond structures and systems, but bring the person back into your organization. And basically, if you are confronted with a strange situation, you don't understand it, there is always a rationale behind it, but you have to be somewhat of a detective, a Sherlock Holmes, to figure out what the rationale is. Much of what happens is out of conscious awareness. We have so many impulses, millions of impulses, but only a very few of them are conscious. And we are more aware of that with neurological experimentation. And then the past is the lens through which you can understand the present and shape the future. You know, what might be good when you were 12 years old, that was a way of survival in difficult situations. And Russia is, you're very tough people. When you think about all the hardships you went through, maybe at the age of 45, that might not be the way to go about it. And we, of course, all have blind spots. We have defenses. The most primitive ones, of course, are splitting. You know, the wolves have black cowboy hats and white cowboy hats, that kind of thing. You know, that, to really, and also never taking personal responsibility, saying, I didn't do it, he or she did do it. So those are some of the primitive defenses. And that we have to keep in mind. When you come back to the past, you see people who react strangely to some other people. And they have to realize, for example, they might have a fairly autocratic father And so they always got into fights with an autocratic father. So when they see a person who reminds them of that father, they go into automatic pilot. So when something happens to you, what you don't understand, an intensive reaction, it's sometimes called, I have not the time to go into that, it's called a transference reaction. So let me continue. You know, the pandemic is not something new. I mean, you look at things, here's some kind of screen, you see a lot of them from the Black Death, smallpox, Spanish flu, and you can go on, SARS. There are a lot of pandemics, so we have had lots of pandemics. The question is, we try to forget it. We don't want to be reminded of it. And I'll say more about that in a second. So it's nothing new, and unfortunately, the leaders in our world were not willing to think about it, many of them at least. When I've been talking to some people, I wrote an article about it not too long ago, about the six horsemen of the apocalypse. Actually, there are four horsemen if you take the New Testament. And the four horsemen of the apocalypse are global warming. Actually, in 1962, a book came out from a lady, and she warned about the dangers of global warming already. It was pesticides. Then 2 years later, there was this tragic comedy, probably not shown in Russia in 64. It was about nuclear holocaust. It was a crazy American general who wanted to start a fight with Russia. And still, I mean, this nuclear holocaust is there. Look at North Korea. Look at a failed state like Pakistan. Then, not too long ago, a book came out in France by Piketty about income inequalities, and it has become worse. And it is in many countries the case, and that is a seed for social unrest. Most countries in the world have that, except probably my country, Holland, and some of the Nordic countries is much less. Terrorism, which is always there, and now we have the coronavirus pandemic, and on top of it, when you look at the world, we have lots of dysfunctional leadership. There was a famous a businessman, Warren Buffett, who said, when the water goes down, you know, the ebb goes down, you see who is naked. And many of the leaders we see at the moment have been quite naked, to say at the least. I forgot about that. There's also, there's something called the doomsday clock, which was instigated many years ago by some eminent scientist. And it used to have minutes to before midnight. It has changed this year for 100 seconds before midnight. So this is not a happy world for our children and our grandchildren, to be frank. You know, we realize that the world is not a sum-sum game. It's a zero-sum game. We can destroy the world. Okay, when you are in crisis situations, what happens usually, and I'm now taking a macro perspective, given, you know, the pandemic, we experience we get anxious. When we get anxious, we have a sense of helplessness. When we are helpless, we have dependency reactions. Plus, we have also paranoid reactions, which, by the way, demagogues will take advantage of. You know, somebody out to get us, to create some kind of unity. And we start to look for messiahs, people who are going to solve all our problems. And we have seen that too much in too many countries. And there is a danger, given the pandemic, that there is already quite some autocratic leadership in the world. It will become worse. That is, I think, one thing one should keep in mind. And when I take a micro perspective, you have another problem. We are social animals. We are herd animals. We like to be close to each other. To be locked up is not natural. To engage in social distances is not natural. And it creates many mental health issues. Now, we have a frustration for the need for belonging. It's a basic human existential need. And again, we have paranoid reactions. You know, I got invited for next week to have dinner with a friend who lives not too far from now. But I start to wonder, does he have the coronavirus? The person who is going to be cooking, does she have the coronavirus? So this paranoid feeling. And by the way, when you get frustrated, there are two reactions. One is anger in, which results in substance abuse, like alcohol, drugs, and also depressive reactions. And the other thing is anger out, violence. So one could assume, imagine, I'm a luxury animal at the moment. I mean, the children out of the house, we have a big garden, but think about it being stuck in a small apartment in Paris. with two small or three small children. It gets on your nerves. So there might be a lot of also some violence in the families, and you might expect an increase in the divorce rate. I would not be surprised about that. And apparently, when you think about the helplines in many European countries, there's a lot of violence against women, that's to say the least. By the way, as an aside, when you look at leadership at the moment, I mean, let me continue for a moment. And I'll say something about it in a minute. It's a famous statement by Sophocles. He said, "It's hard to learn the mind of any mortal, or the heart, till he be tried in chief authority. Power shows the man." He said man. He was, I guess in those days it were all men. But very quickly, the shadow side of leadership can come out in these pandemic situations. In addition, and this I think is quite an important slide to me at least, okay, you see in Magritte and his paintings, but as I said before, many leaders don't know themselves. Above the temple of Apollo in ancient Greece was written, "Know thyself," and is still the case. And what I do in my work is to make people more aware of their strengths and weaknesses, also realizing that leadership is a team sport. It's a team sport. I mean, nobody can do it alone. And if you are a leader, you should know your weaknesses and find somebody else to do things for you. Actually, I developed some kind of questionnaire to help assess that. Many leaders there's a word in the Greek language called hubris, become too arrogant. You know, when you are very powerful, people have a tendency to tell you what you want to hear. And before you know it, you live in an echo chamber. You only hear what you want to hear, and you don't learn anything anymore. Also, many leaders don't get the best out of their people, which is very striking to me. When I do my seminar the first week, people realize they don't really know their people. They don't know what motivates their people. And they had never had any meaningful conversation with them. Many leadership teams function very poorly. Top executive teams, I say often, is a natural act. At INSEAD, I have introduced team coaching. I mean, we are probably now the biggest provider of team coaching in the world. And also KDVI, we have something. Okay. So I always say, give me somewhat neurotic executive team, and I make something out of it. And I'm always surprised that people spend tens of millions of dollars, euros, whatever, on IT systems, but they don't spend anything on making the teams aligned. And that costs much more money. And also, as I said, many organizations have a gulag quality. Think about the lack of engagement of many executives. Now, one thing I was saying, that in the pandemic, there is a possibility that not the best leadership will rise to the occasion. I mean, one is, of course, the malignant narcissistic personality. I mean, you don't have to go far to see the great example of that. Just go to the United States. Certainly, America is not making America great again. Basically, it has become some kind of a laughing stock. But if you talk about narcissism, you see grandiosity, need for admiration, feeling special, sense of entitlement, Machiavellianism, paranoia, antisocial traits, and the malignant part is a lack of empathy, which you can see very much when you have ever had the opportunity to see Trump interact about the pandemic. There was a total lack of empathy. And also a sadistic streak. Don't cross him because he gets back at you. And that's a very nasty, I mean, all leaders, by the way, are narcissistic to some extent. And you have to be somewhat narcissistic. It's part of self-confidence. But it's a question of degree. Now, here's some examples of political leadership, which I don't get too excited about. They all have their, we talk about Al-Sisi, anybody who criticizes him, including the family members, are locked up. Anyhow, I don't want to go. You can draw your own conclusions about all those glorious leaders, and they will not get better, I can assure you that, from Brazil to Turkey to whatever. Now, we are at an inflection point, and we have to make some choices. You know, where do we want to go? I guess the more pessimistic scenario is actually, I asked someone, how's the world going to be afterwards? He said, the same, only worse. You know, real cheerleader, the same, only worse. That's not what I really like to go. But you see, it's somewhat of a circling of the wagons. I already mentioned the danger of social unrest, scapegoating, which also might, I mean, the first form of scapegoating, of course, is wars, and wars are extremely costly. I mean, Russia is a prime example of how much the wars have cost you. I mean, I come from a small country, and I mean, my generation is very aware of, you know, of the war. And also, the pessimistic scenario, we already have lots of apps. We can think about an Orwellian police state. That is, my more hopeful scenario is we had the time to think about ourselves. It's very rare that you do a major social experiment. So people have been locked up. And I was thinking about I think it's a Russian expression, the Boldino Auto moment. I was listening to an aria of Lenski in Eugene Onegin, I guess. And I was very touched by the aria. And then I start to ask myself, when did he write it? He didn't write it, it was Tchaikovsky, of course, of the opera, but when did he write the play or the verse? And he was apparently locked up in Boldino, like we are. Many of us are locked up. And he was warned not to go to Boldino. I think it's 600 kilometers from Moscow, but he went anyhow because he was in a hurry to get married. It can happen. And then he couldn't come back because of a cholera epidemic. So he's locked up for 3 months. And apparently it was his most productive period because it offered him a lot of reflectivity. I mean, I must say, I've also been here, in my little mountain there. It has been a very productive period for writing that way. But I'm trying to take advantage of reflectivity, that this enormous social experiment, not running from one place to the other, taking planes and all the other busyness, you know, this manic defense, and having more Gemeinschaft, you know, more community sense. I start to know my neighbors. Never did before. I mean, it was so sterile, but now walking around, talk to your neighbors, even though there was some social distancing. Of course, we're looking for trustworthy leaders. Can we have trust? That's one. And it also, you know, this pandemic will have an effect on more innovative ways of working. I mean, in the past, we wanted people to be in the office because the bosses wanted to see them to work. They want to control them. But now they can't control them, and they still work. Now, some people, of course, need a social environment sometimes, but you can very well work from home, as many people have shown, without somebody hanging over you. Of course, many people who are authoritarian personalities still like to boss people around physically. You see, by the way, the social safety net. It's an interesting phenomenon. Europe has, of course, I mean, talk about Western Europe, has, of course, lots of tragedies because of the pandemic, but we have a better social safety net. And you look at America, it's a total mess. It's a total mess. I mean, health-wise, and I mean, it's a total mess. And that is, of course, another thing. What the pandemic showed is, even though it might have been originating in China, it's everywhere. So we cannot isolate ourselves. You know, we are part of a global world, and we better accept that. So, and unfortunately, many international bodies are not the most functional bodies. I mean, you talk about the United Nations, the World Trade Organization, the World Health Organization, Red Cross, but we have to make investment in international bodies. We have to do research together because the world will not be at a new normal unless an antibody is found. And that will take, I mean, probably a year that has to be produced. Let me continue. I have, you know, the kind of leaders we need, and we have some rise to the occasion. I was making the earlier comment about the leaders, and actually female leaders, surprise, surprise, do somewhat better. When you look at some of the countries with female leadership, like Denmark, like Finland, like New Zealand, like Taiwan, like Germany, they did much better than all those gentlemen. I mean, you talk about in England, Boris, and of course my friend Trump. I mean, for a friend, that's an understatement. But I mean, the kind of general clown who America is now, who is totally incompetent, as we saw But what we need is people who can deal with complexity, our system thinker. I remember some years ago, I was at Davos, and I met one of you oligarchs, and I was telling him, one of the better-known oligarchs actually in your country, said, if you want to have more, he was a hunter, apparently, if you want to have more lions, you should have to shoot elephants. And he looked at me very surprised. Now, it is a very simple solution to it. When there are too many elephants, like in Botswana or Zimbabwe or South Africa, they destroy the forest. When there is no forest, there are no antelopes. When there are no antelopes, no fertility for the lions. So it's very simple. So you need people who can do some system thinking. Second, a sense of confidence. That you can learn. I mean, to have some self-confidence. And I mean, I see it in my class. Many of the people are not as secure. I mean, the typical comment about, for example, McKinsey directors is insecure overachievers. So much for security. It pushes them a little bit. Element of care. They care about what they're doing. They have compassion. Now, they feel. I mean, it's a fade. You know, you look at Trump, and he's so often seen. There's a lack of compassion. Also, courage. I wrote an article this week for the Harvard Business Review about courage, taking courageous decisions. I'll say something more about it later. And also, you have to and critical thinking. You know, as I said before, you don't want to be in an echo chamber. You want to have people around you who has a kind of, you know, respect, but also can argue back for the boss. So you learn something. And then, of course, communication. You have to communicate, and communicate more than ever now. Let me continue. You know, this is a kind of a complex model. It's in one of my last books I'm writing. I actually finished writing. And these are our existential challenges, and you have to direct it. I mean, we are, and there was a famous book by Viktor Frankl, Man in Search of Meaning. He was a concentration camp survivor. And people who had a sense of meaning were the ones more likely to survive. So you need to have a sense of purpose. Purpose is future-oriented. What do you want to do in the future? You need to have a sense of belonging, which is difficult at the moment, but you have, at least you can have your close family around, and you can do it somewhat virtual. You like to have a sense of control. You have to make some decisions in life, and the major decisions usually are partner choice and also career choice. We all have a gift. Use your gift. You know, when you feel, you lose a sense of time. You have this sense of what's called flow. You know, take advantage of it. And then I hope that you say, you know, it's a world we all share, to do something more, this kind of altruistic part. Do something more than just for you, being out for yourself. So that is really our existential challenges, and any existential psychology will tell you. So my recommendation is make the world grow great again, not America great again, which means we need hope. Now, leaders are merchants of hope, to quote an invader of Russia called Napoleon. Leaders are merchants of hope, to speak to your imagination. Without hope, we're dead. Also, we need to create trust. At the moment, there is very little trust in leadership. Sweden is the only country which is trying to do the herd immunity system, and they can do it because they trust the government. They trust them, which is not the case when you look at many other countries. Also, the case of pride. I mean, I've been in Russia many times and have seen how that developed over the years. And the other thing is transcending greed. We need some greed, of course. It motivates us. But my father always said, I can only eat one steak a day. How many steaks do you want to eat? Do you want a bigger car? Do you want a bigger house? You know, is that what you need? Do you need? And of course, the most powerful person in a way is a man like Buddha, who has no needs. And so create a global world, meaning you have Gemeinschaft, you have communities, we want part of our identity, but also we have some international bodies who relate to each other because we're all in the same boat. So to end, I just want to make a comment. You know, you say, what can I do? I'm helpless. And there was a famous comment made by this anthropologist who I was admired, Margaret Mead, who said, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, is the only thing that ever has. And I tend to tell a story. It's in a way a koan, which is a Japanese-Chinese word for puzzle. But there's something true in it. It's about a story of a man who is having a walk on the beach. And there has been a great storm the night before. And so there are thousands and thousands of sea stars on the beach. And so the man, and he sees there far away a young woman taking one sea star at a time and throw it back in the water. So he walks over to the young woman and said, "What are you doing? There are too many of them. You can make a difference." And she said, "It makes a difference to this one." And so we all have to take charge. And you see in many countries, actually, that it's not the leaders who have taken charge, that people below them have taken charge. The same thing, maybe also to some extent, you see it in America, in particular in New York with this Governor Cuomo. You see it in many other countries, also in Russia. Other people take charge, and all of you have to take charge. So here I am. This is the end of my talk, and now I'm very curious about some of your questions.